This is Spurslandia,
episode 1. We made it. Today on Spurslandia, we have a very special guest, the man from down under, Mr. Patty Mills. Well, Patty Mills, I would like to welcome you to the official podcast of the San Antonio Spurs called Spurslandia, which I think might have some extra meaning to you because you played in Portland for a couple years, and our inspiration for the name was Portlandia. And in fact, I believe, were you on an episode of Portlandia?
Yeah, I think I was on an episode managed, I think it was my second year.
What was that experience like?
Yeah, it was good. Really good. Obviously coming from Australia and getting in the mix of the Portland culture, it was interesting, but really enjoyed the show. I remember doing it at the practice facility. But Spurslandia, it's an interesting name. I wonder who came up with that one.
Yeah, I have no idea. But whoever did is obviously really smart. Every time I try to do an interview with you, it ends up deteriorating into shenanigans and giggles and a lot of laughs because, you know, we're friends. So I'm really trying to take this one serious, and I'm trying to like pretend that we're not good friends because I don't, you know, we get into the inside jokes, the inside stories. I don't know if the average Spurs fan is going to think it's as funny as we do. And I want to keep this chronological and pretend like, all right, Patty Mills, who is this guy? I want to find out what makes him tick. I want to know what he's all about. So I'm going to go way back, and I want you to describe to us the first time you played organized basketball.
Oh, wow. The first time that I played organized basketball. That is a great question, actually. And I just came across a photo on my phone, but I would have been about... I would have been 3, not quite 4 years old yet.
Whoa. You played organized basketball when you turned 4 years old?
I did indeed. Here's a picture because I just got it sent to me right here.
How could you reach the hoop?
I couldn't. I still can't.
DeJounte in a post-game interview, I think against the Timberwolves in the second game, said that when he was 5, he used to play pickup against 15-year-olds, his like uncles and cousins and stuff. And that's why he's such a good rebounder, because it's the only way he could get the ball.
Yeah.
Now, 5 years old, you're talking even younger than that. 4 years old, you were playing organized basketball. I mean, what was that experience like?
So obviously very, very vague memories for me. But the thing that I remember the most and you know, what parents and families would tell me that I would be on the court absolutely having no idea what was going on. The ball and the rest of the players would be on one side of the court and I would be on the other side of the court with a bigger smile on my face, just happy to be out there with friends and a couple of cousins as well. So that was my first experience of organized basketball, yeah.
Was it love at first sight?
Well, I can't remember it that clearly, so maybe it wasn't.
You just wanted to be playing with trains or something?
Nah, it was definitely sports, but I think more than anything, like at that point, it could have been anything, to be honest, whether it was basketball or Australian rules football or rugby, anything really. I think I just enjoyed the doing it with other people, like a team atmosphere. Hence why, you know, I didn't care what I was doing out there. I was just, you know, pumped to be out there.
When was the moment where you were like, this is my sport, this is my passion, this is what I want to pursue?
Yeah, later than probably you would assume, but probably not until I went to college for basketball. There was an opportunity for me to go down another path with Australian rules football. So that was always hanging around too. But for me to go to college, I think that was really the deciding factor of, all right, basketball it is, and I'll stick with it.
How did you end up going to St. Mary's all the way from Australia?
Yeah, it's an interesting question because, you know, the pinnacle of basketball in Australia at that development level is the AIS. It's the Olympic training venue for Australians. So I went to the AIS for 3 years, and I was there at the same time that Andrew Bogut got drafted number one into the NBA. So of course, him going to Utah for a couple of years, University of Utah, then getting drafted to the league, they all wanted to know where Andrew Bogut came from. So all of a sudden you had scouts coming to the AIS where Andrew Bogut went as well, to see if there was another 7'2" massive Australian, but there wasn't. There was only a, a 6-foot black Australian there prancing around. So yeah, anyway, that's where all the college coaches came to scout us, and St. Mary's was one of them.
Who else recruited you?
The only other college that recruited me was the University of Utah, and that were my official visits. Yeah.
And you went and visited before making the decision?
I did. Yep. All by myself.
And what was that experience like? I mean, was that your first time in America?
It wasn't my first time in America. I'd been before with a couple of tours with our AIS team on the West Coast, Seattle, Portland, and LA and San Francisco. But this was the first visit by myself. And obviously, it's a massive decision. I was just overwhelmed. Like, it was overwhelming. It was a lot going on, a lot for me to take in and process at such a young age too. I mean, you're sent across the other side of the world to essentially decide your future in a sense. So there was a lot of pressure, I guess, because I didn't know what I was going to, you know, go back to Australia and back to mum and dad. And I don't know what to tell him. Like, yeah, Utah was cold and San Francisco is nice. You know, I just really had no idea. But at the end of the day, you know, just really felt good, had a good feeling, I guess, about St. Mary's and rolled with that.
Do they have college sports in Australia?
No, we don't. No, nothing like the US, mate.
So you just go to college to learn. That's it.
Oh, yeah, I think so. I think that's the point of college.
So if you're trying to go professional in a sport and you're in Australia, what are your options then? Is it obviously it's different by sport, but for basketball, is the likely path to try to go to the States to college, or do you go right to the pros in Europe or China?
Exactly. Those are the two options right there. When you come out of high school, you've got the opportunity to go straight professional and play in the NBL. Or if you want to go to college, you know, go down that route. For other sports, it's pretty much the same as well. Australian rules football, you know, you're coming straight out of high school, going straight to the pros. Rugby, all of those sports is the same. So it's interesting, the dynamic between college sports over here in the US and back in Australia. But no college sports in Australia, hence why I came over here.
So how do you get into AIS? Are you selected by a committee? Do they try to identify the top athletes in each sport and send them there for high school to give them a head start with the training?
Yeah, exactly. So you play for your club, whatever city you're in.
What was your club?
My club was Shadows.
I do hope you're enjoying my interview with Patty Mills. Don't forget to please subscribe. Thanks so much. Now back to Patty.
It started in Canberra, and Canberra is the capital of Australia, like the Washington, D.C., for example. So you had a lot of Indigenous people from around the country coming to Canberra to work, and they needed a common ground. So my mum and dad created Shadows Basketball Club for these families to come and feel like, you know, there was people like-minded and you know, somewhere where they could feel comfortable. And that's what Shadows was. So I grew up my whole life playing for Shadows all the way up until I went to the AIS.
So it was a family venture then. Your parents were involved with your basketball at a young age?
Oh, yeah, for sure. It was all because of them. But, you know, again, even more so than just basketball. Like, basketball ended up just being the vehicle, right? It could have been anything. But, you know, with their line of work, they were always about bettering the lives of Indigenous people. And basketball just happened to be that vehicle. So you had a lot of kids, junior teams, senior teams, but you had both Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that would come and play in this club. And it ended up turning into a multicultural club where we had African boys and girls coming to play. We had Indian boys and girls coming to play. And it became this multicultural club because it was so inclusive to everyone, and that's the feeling. It was like a really community-based club that was far beyond basketball. This is getting a little bit deep now, but that's the impact of what Shadows was. Yeah,
that's good. We want to go deep. It's a podcast. Is Shadows still exist now?
You know what? Shadows is still around. There's no teams that haven't played any games or haven't had any teams for a number of years, but I've been working on something very special that has kind of elevated what Shadows used to be to a national level. And again, it's all about creating opportunities and pathways for, you know, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander minority people who just don't have those opportunities in the current system because of a lot of barriers. So, yeah.
I think that's great. I mean, anything anyone can do to give kids the opportunity to go after and have access to achieving whatever they're passionate about is huge. You know, every kid deserves that chance to have that type of access. So I applaud you big time for that. So back to where we were in the timeline. So you head to St. Mary's, you play 2 years there, correct? And then you're like, I'm going lottery. I'm leaving early. I'm going to go get paid. And then you end up getting drafted 55th. You almost didn't get drafted. What was that like on like that draft process and draft night? What were you thinking? What were your expectations? What was that experience?
Well, I wasn't a hot commodity like you, my friend, but yeah. I had to hang in there. But yeah, two years at St. Mary's. First of all, college journey was a great experience for me, both on and off the court, playing for sure. Met my wife my sophomore year, and not long after that, this doesn't go hand in hand, but it's just how I'm saying it. Not long after that, I broke my hand, and that was my first injury, and I was pretty much out for the rest of the season. I came back at the end to play a couple of NIT games. But that was a big decision on me entering the draft and testing the waters and seeing what it was like. Me at that point, you know, it was really my first injury. I didn't know what to expect, if my hand would ever be the same again. I never knew.
Was it your shooting hand?
It was my shooting hand, yep. Broke the third and fourth metacarpal here. There you go, just showing off my medical knowledge.
You getting a bar fight?
Nah, mate. Nah.
Okay. Good.
See, here we
That's
go.
That's a high again. Character. You're too high character. I knew that wasn't true.
But yeah, that was a big decision for me to you know, enter the draft, and I did. And you know, for me, coming from where I come from, it was a big deal. So ended up going to New York for the draft, Madison Square Garden. And sure enough, was drafted to Portland at 55. There was no one else in Madison Square Garden at that point. It was only Adam Silver, myself, and my family. I think a few cleaners had come in. The lights had gone on to sweep up the popcorn and rubbish and stuff. But nonetheless, I went up on stage and collected my hat, and it was a very, very special moment, yeah.
And the good thing about getting drafted 55th at this point in your career is you're going down as like one of the biggest draft steals ever. When people every year at the draft, when they get in the second round on TV and they get up in, you know, the 40s, the 50s, and they'll put up on the board notable picks at 55. Patty Mills, sure as heck, first name on that list. So you got that going to you, which is nice.
Yes.
So you go to Portland, you're kind of back and forth with the G League, correct? You know, what was your mindset coming into the NBA? Like, as the 55th pick, you really had to earn your place. What was your whole attitude coming into the NBA?
Yeah, well, this is probably the next step in my journey that I guess for me, this is 2009, the year of 2009 that we're talking about, wasn't a highlight year, but a massive learning year for me. So after coming off my hand injury, getting back, into some sort of shape and rhythm to be able to play basketball again, got drafted, and then went to summer league camp in Portland. So this is in July. And the first drill of the first practice of the first day of summer league training camp, I come down on someone else's foot and break my foot for my second career injury in the same year. So that was defining moment, I think, for me. And it definitely tested my character. But I was out for the rest of the remaining of that year. Still was able to snatch a roster spot on the Portland Trail Blazers, but I actually didn't come back playing until the new year. So I think it was January, maybe mid to late January, that I came back and played my first NBA game. And from that point, it was just trying to get game reps under my belt. So yeah, I went to the Idaho Stampede to see if I was, fit enough to play and get back into playing again. So that was good for me, just to get back out on the court. But the first year was definitely a massive learning year in the NBA for me. It was pretty much all rehab and learning the ways of how the NBA operates, I guess. The second year in Portland was, I guess, the year that I settled in a little bit more and was able to make an impact for the team.
Yeah, and I tell kids all the time at the Bonner basketball camp, you're going to go through adversity, not just on the court. It could be off the court. You don't know where it's going to come from. But being able to overcome that adversity does build character and makes you stronger and better moving forward. And that's clearly what you did with those two pretty significant basketball injuries in one year. Do you think that having the G League as a place to develop young players is productive for the league as opposed to them just sitting on the end of the bench, not getting to play?
Oh, 100%. Yeah, definitely in my case, obviously coming off a major injury, it was important for me to get game reps under my belt. But even on, even in the case of, guys being healthy, but just not having the opportunity to play, it's massively important. Because, we've seen it. Guys can be on the end of the bench and, a month, 2 months goes by and they don't have a chance to play. So it's probably the most frustrating thing as a player, as a competitor, because you want to be out there and compete. So to be able to have the G League there, I think is super important and super helpful for these young guys.
So at the end of March 2012, I'm sure you can remember this specific time quite well because you came to San Antonio to play for the Spurs. And I'll never forget the first time I saw you because I was coming into practice and you were in the weight room. They were doing like some testing, physical testing and stuff. We call it a scuzz or a buzz cut. All your hair was chopped off. You look like you were like 15 years old. You had zero muscle definition. And now you look like you should be on the cover of Men's Fitness. You're like chiseled 12 pack of abs. It's ridiculous. How did you go from that Patty Mills to the Patty Mills we see now? What was your approach when it came to nutrition, working out, that whole side of the game?
Yeah, I don't know about this, mate. You're like starting some rumors here with your first appearance. I might need to see some evidence of this person that you're describing here.
I just look at Instagram. That's all I got.
my first, I was caught in a little bit of a pickle, to be honest, after the lockdown in 2011, lockout in 2011. And there was a lot of things that went on there. It was just unfortunate times for me. I've just had two pretty significant injuries in 2009. I played pretty much didn't play my first rookie year in the league. My second year was the first time that, all right, here we go, you know, and started to play. And then, boom, the lockout happened. So for me, the decision to work out what do I do during the lockout, what was an important one. Do I sit out even longer and not play basketball games again, which wasn't ideal, or do I find somewhere where I can continue to play somehow after already not playing for a whole year? And that's when I made the decision to go back to Australia and play in the league there, just to be able to practice and play. And that was cool because that was the first time that my family had really gotten to see me play, you know, in front of them and whatever. But that was kind of a tough time because, the NBA came back on and now I've got to try and find my way back into the NBA. And then I guess the business side of things is which I kind of, got hit with and realized. So there was a big waiting period for me after that, before coming to San Antonio. But I guess, you know, coming to San Antonio, I didn't know what to expect, really. There was also pressure on the fact that the 2012 Olympics was coming up. And for me not to have a whole lot of reps under my belt for the last couple of years isn't good heading into an Olympics, especially, you know, the season before. So I didn't know what to expect. I just wanted to come in and work hard and try to find my way, I guess. And after the first couple of weeks or so, I really got to have a sense of the environment that I was in. Some really good veterans, some really good comedians, just really understood that this was a great place for me to be able to learn, grow and continue to develop. From that point on, it was just what I got to do to stay here pretty much.
Well, clearly it was an amazing fit because you're in your 10th season. Welcome to the Spurs 10-year club, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, man.
I'm at the bottom of that totem pole, just for the record.
Do we get to cheer something or what? We're cheering anything?
Cheers.
Yeah. 10
years. Virtual
club.
Cheers. 10 years. Cheers. Yeah. Anyone listening has no idea what we just did. But when you talk about that time when you were back in Australia playing in the NBL, was there ever a fear like I might not make it back to the NBA?
No, it wasn't. I was just kind of really enjoying the part of being home. And being with friends and being with family and that. But I don't think so. And maybe I was still young enough and naive to even think that probably could have been a possibility. I was just kind of head down and just going about my business pretty much. But thinking about it now, I mean, it 100% could have been exactly that way. You know, you throw in another little injury there or, you know, whatever, business side of things, whatever, you know, yeah, you could be out the door before you know it.
I agree. That is scary. And you see, for me, I played 1 year in Italy, my first year, and there were a lot of guys over there who I was like, these guys are definitely good enough to play in the NBA, but they leave the NBA and a lot of them just don't make it, find their way back over there for whatever reason, for the reasons you talked about. Maybe they're happy where they are playing. They're, you know, they get to be the star on their team versus having to start at the bottom on a roster and work their way up role wise for a variety of reasons. Those things definitely do happen. I call you you probably don't know this because you don't watch our broadcast, but I call you the Iron Man, the Spurs Iron Man. And I wish I could get our producers to play Black Sabbath Iron Man every time I do it, like that robot voice in the beginning of the song, but they can't because it's like a copyright infringement. But you've missed, I think, 3 games in the last 5+ seasons. Like how have you been able to stay healthy and maintain your level of fitness and injury prevention?
When were those 3 games, you know?
I have no idea. I didn't do that much research for this.
I think they were all of those 3 games were in the bubble, I think, in Orlando.
Oh, I'm not counting those games because you were healthy, but they just didn't play. You had, and for all I know, the three games before the bubble you missed, you could have been healthy and they just like, eh, we're not playing you tonight. But the point is like, and not, I'm knocking on wood left and right. I mean, you've taken care of yourself. Like what's been the secret?
Yeah, I think going through my hand and going through my foot in 2009 was definitely a turning point for me to get to understand my body a lot more. And then in between that and then my next, significant injury where I missed a lot of games was with my shoulder. And I guess I just wanted to really understand my body a lot more and how I needed to look after it so that it can perform at its highest level, you know. We always talk about our body being the tools of the trade, and for us to keep that sharp is extremely important. So I dived not only into nutrition, I dived into sports science, I dived into body mechanics, and I really, I was intrigued by all of it. You know, the body is so fascinating in itself anyway. And year by year, I get deeper and deeper into it and just try to find little ways to be able to, keep it as sharp as possible. For a lot of people that don't know, we go from an NBA season and go back to Australia and play on the national team. So we end up, for a few years, we end up playing a year round, which is a lot on the body. The other thing and the other reasons why I dive deep into that kind of stuff is because of my stature. Obviously, being one of the smallest guys in the NBA, if not the smallest, I really do got to try and find all the little, tricks of the trade, I guess you can call them, or efficient ways to be able to play my game. Obviously, guys that are taller and longer and more athletic, they can probably get away with a lot more, especially guys that can jump out of the gym, you know. But for me, not having that luxury, just really understanding how the body function works so that I can make efficient movements, essentially is what it is. So anyway, I get into a little bit of a nerdy situation talking about those, but it's what makes me tick. Yeah.
I wish I had learned how to make efficient movements when I played. That's one of my biggest regrets. I don't think there was a more inefficient mover in the NBA than myself. I mean, look at you. You're 32 years old. I know, it's 10 games into the season and you probably don't want to talk about stats, but you're averaging career highs in points, true shooting percentage, 3-point percentage, free throw percentage, free throws made per game, made threes per game. And you're like right at your career highs in overall field goal percentage. Rebounds, gang rebounding, you know how important that is to Coach Pop. And the last one. So first of all, most people's careers start to decline at the age of 32. Yours is like going through the roof. Jim Cramer would be screaming, "Buy Patty Mills right now." So kudos to that. And then the last stat I want to talk about, you've tied your career high in blocks per game at 0.1. I did the math, 0.1 times 10 games. That's one block. So I don't know who you blocked, but that needs to be on your highlight film. And I got a question for you. In a average season, do you think I get more dunks or you get more blocks?
I get more blocks, mate. 100%.
No way. No chance.
What are you counting?
I'm going to look it up.
Are you counting the layup line?
Yeah, I'm counting anytime.
Any. Well, yeah, you still don't even dunk in the layup line or practice.
That's because I never dunk outside of a game when it happens.
Well, do you dunk in
games? You think I dunk in games?
I mean, you dunk it like you do it on the regular. I could probably count on my one hand how many times you dunk in your career. And you should dunk. You're like,
that's not true.
How tall
are
you?
That's not true. I'd get like 20 dunks a year.
Those big calves of yours, you should be dunking every time.
Big calves?
Yeah.
I know I should, but I have inefficient movements. What can I say? All right. Last thing I want to talk about, and jokes aside, this is probably the most meaningful subject. And, you know, your ability to connect with the community, social causes, it, to me is, you know, tops out of anyone I've ever known in my entire life. And I thought what you did during the bubble games, during the whole Black Lives movement, Black Lives Matter movement, where you basically donated your entire salary from those 8 bubble games. I'm not going to talk about how much money that was, but it was a lot of money, very generous to Black Lives Matter organizations in Australia. What organizations in Australia did you end up choosing to support and why?
Yeah, well, I think I'll start with the fact that, because a lot of people that, you know, are listening or that hear this second, third hand, you know, probably, you know, don't understand where it all comes from. But I guess, you know, when you understand my upbringing and where I come from, and the strong connection to culture that I've always had, I was born into, it's a really small and tight, unique community, essentially what it is. That's the Indigenous community of Australia. And we are a small percentage. And when you think about, you know, the ability for me to be able to make somewhere like the NBA, it's a needle in the haystack situation. Back in the day, you had Australia making up 100% of Indigenous Australians making up 100% of the population. Today in 2020, which is less than 3%, it's 2.6%. Indigenous Australians make up the total population. So when you see how minorities are treated over here now, living in America, and don't forget, now that I'm in a different country, my appearance still is the same as other people that have the same color skin as I do. So now I fit into another box, which I was, I guess not too surprised, because I've, you know, witnessed that my whole life anyway. When everything, became heightened, and we had the opportunity to make the most out of the NBA platform, then it was the right thing to do was to be able to make the most of this opportunity to highlight a lot of the same problems that were coming in Australia at the same time. Deaths in custody, the imprisonment rate of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander. And for everyone that's watching, Indigenous Australians are known as black people in Australia, just to have some context there. And it's a dark history in Australia, and one that a lot of Australians are too ashamed to speak about, but history is history, and it's my part to be able to tell that side of history, I guess, on my journey. Just like my family's legacy, I guess, and what my family has always done, especially my mum and dad, is try and better the lives of Black Australians, whether that's through education, whether that's through health. That's been the most important part. And again, it comes from that sense of community and what you can do, to play your part in bettering the community. So that's where it all comes from anyway. So just making the most of that NBA platform to be able to, shine a light on some things that were going on, not only in the US, but in Australia. The thing that's probably hurt me, or that, just got thrown on top of everything that was happening here in the US, was that there were a lot of Australian reporters that were reporting it and saying that, it's amazing to hear all this stuff because we don't go through this in Australia. And I think that's where, I really got emotionally involved to try and do something that was really impactful. And that's where it came from. So to answer your question, mate, we have created the Indigenous Basketball Australia, which is a basketball league holding competitions and programs for youth and communities as well, being able to create those opportunities and pathways for kids in basketball especially. We've got a We Got You campaign, which highlights the positivity of creating safe environments in the sporting fields that's free from discrimination, any types of discrimination and racism. What we want at the end of the day is we want our kids and we want our people to be able to play sport, play something that they love in an environment that's free from all of that stuff, so that they can just enjoy it. And also another important one is land management. We obviously had some very, very bad fire disasters in February of 2020, so almost a year ago. It kind of ended in February, March. The land management ways of giving back again, it's about the knowledge of how to look after the land. And this comes from Indigenous knowledge. And again, these are all barriers that that get put up because it's minority knowledge, right? It's not the ways of the Western world. So they, certain people just don't want to hear it. But for me to be able to highlight the fact that, no, we can look after our land. There is thousands and thousands of years of knowledge from my people that know exactly how to look after the land to prevent any type of wildfires. The way of the Western world isn't preventable. So things like that, those three are the main on the list. I've just partnered with Bluestone Lane that's providing Black Australians to come over from Australia to work in a Bluestone Lane cafe in hospitality, no training or anything, just to get involved and get some experience over here and working throughout that. The best thing about that opportunity is that these kids that come over naturally through hospitality get to teach people and educate people on who they are. If they look exactly like me and they're delivering a coffee or making a coffee or delivering food, whatever it may be, throughout hospitality, that naturally comes over in a genuine conversation. So, that's the way of educating people on their own identity, which I think is really cool. So, we can keep rattling off a couple more, but I think those ones are a lot to start with.
That's incredible, mate. I mean, you're right. You could keep going with everything you do to make this world a better place. And I think it's amazing what everyone in the NBA who uses their platform to what you just talked about, to educate, to inform, to enlighten a lot of the issues we have. I think going back to your point about the Australian reporters, we don't have that here. People just don't know. And someone has to shine a light on the problems and inform and educate and make these issues a reality. And for what you've done to work towards that, in addition to helping create those opportunities for all the youth, for all the kids, to create that equality, to level the playing field, I think is amazing. And it makes me really proud to have been your teammate and be your friend. And that's all I have to say on that, I guess.
Nah, thank you, mate. Nah, it means a lot.
It inspires me, and I hope it inspires the younger players on the team. I mean, you're a vet now. You're one of the OGs on the Spurs and in the league, really. There's not a ton of much older players than you. That to be, you're not just a basketball player. You're a complete human. Your legacy and what you can affect goes beyond the basketball court. And I think it's a great example you're setting for sure.
Yeah, I think that's the advice that I would give, being in that position, right? No matter if it's the young boys on our team or anyone that's listening, it's the fact of never forgetting who you are and never forgetting where you come from. And if you had been in a position to be able to succeed, never forgetting, who and what got you to that point, and always give back, because giving back is always a way to make you, yourself feel good at the same time. So I think it's important about your identity, where you come from, and you know what got you there.
Absolutely. And Patty, I know we kept you a few extra minutes, but I thought that stuff needed to be talked about. Thank you so much for coming on Spurslandia, and best of luck the rest of the way. I'm sure you and I will be in touch, but it was awesome having you here. Loved hearing about your journey, and I think anyone who listens to this has a lot they can learn from it.
Thanks for having me, mate.
All right. See you, mate.
See ya.